Välkomna till Global Access. Jag heter Thomas Gyr och jag ska samtala med professor Rana Mitter om kinesisk historieskrivning och hur det används i kinesisk politik idag.
Historia och nutid är rubriken för årets upplaga av Global Access. Går det att dra slutsatser av händelser i det förgångna? Eller är människan dömd att upprepa gårdagens misstag? Hur använder auktoritära regimer det egna landets historia för att säkra makten? Vilken roll spelar den enskilde individen? I programmen försöker forskare, journalister och författare besvara dessa frågor. Rana Mitter menar att forna tidens oförrätter är centrala i den moderna kinesiska historieskrivningen. Genom att ständigt återkomma till britternas övergrepp under opiumkrigen och japanernas illdåd under andra världskriget försöker kommunistpartiet rättfärdiga det egna landets aggressiva utrikespolitik. Denna insikt blir allt viktigare att förstå i takt med att Kinas globala inflytande växer.
China rewrites its own historical narrative today. Actually, it's an official policy of rewriting or redescribing Chinese history. Why are they doing it?
Thomas, for China, history is a very, very central part of the way in which they think about their own identity. Now, you might say that that's a comment that could be true of many countries, but sometimes I think that in Western Europe and North America, we often don't remember our own history enough. We tend to forget a lot of it. In China, you could almost argue that they remember too much, at least at certain times. And I would say that in particular, there are certain events from recent history, by which I mean the last 100 to 150 years, that are brought up over and over again to try and make particular points about China today.
I guess one is the Opium War. Is 1842 or?
Yeah. You're very well informed. Mm. That's right. The Opium War is probably the one that's brought up most commonly, partly because the name tends to be familiar to Westerners. They often will not know very much about when it was or what actually happened. So 1839 was the outbreak of the First Opium War, and it was essentially resolved in, as you say, 1842 with the Treaty of Nanjing, a major town in South Central China. And that tends to be remembered because it was the first treaty at the end of that war to be classed as what the Chinese to this day call the unequal treaties. Unequal in the sense that they imposed conditions on China which were not reciprocated by Britain, France, the United States, and a variety of other countries that essentially used them to gain both territory and special rights in China. So that particular period of the Opium Wars is regarded as a period of what, again, the Chinese to this day call national humiliation. And that explains sometimes the often quite prickly, sometimes rather defensive way in which what seem like intrusions from abroad into Chinese politics are received in China itself.
Mm. So this is the one of the common or main themes: invasions, conflict, humiliation of China. But that's in a way a historical past, I guess. So what conclusions are drawn from that past for the present?
These events are very much past in terms of being things that happened, certainly in the way that the Chinese Communist Party, the ruling party of China today, thinks about them from before its own victory in 1949. But they're very much part of the present day way in which the party thinks about its domestic politics and its international relations. And to put it at its most brief, the reason that these historical examples are brought out and discussed is that they illustrate or provide an analogy for various things that China wants to do today. So to give one particular example, one very rich source of historical analogy, and I suspect we'll talk more about this because it's worth diving into, is the Second World War period. Now, I'm sure that many people will be quite well informed, but it is possible to find people in the West who, of course, know about the Second World War, but aren't aware that China had any particularly significant role in it. So this initially is a point of some resentment for many in China today, that the fact that 10 to 14 million Chinese were killed in China during that period is not well remembered outside China itself. So during that Second World War period, one of the things that happened was the conference between the then Chinese leader, the nationalist leader Chiang Kai-shek, and President Roosevelt of the United States, and of course Winston Churchill of Britain. They met at Cairo, capital of Egypt, near the pyramids, and put together an agreement about what would happen after the war was over and Japan was defeated.
So that was the Cairo meeting of 1943.
Exactly, yes. November 1943. Now, the details of that have really only been remembered by historians who are looking into the details, often the rather obscure details, of what happened in Egypt in those days in November 1943. But exactly 70 years later, in the autumn of 2013, just a few years ago, Chinese diplomats, Chinese think tankers, Chinese policy analysis specialists started to talk very loudly in China about this Cairo conference. And the reason was that at the end of the conference, back in 1943, a communique, a statement was made by the Allied powers, the Americans, the British, and the Chinese, talking about what would happen to certain territories, including islands in the Pacific, or in the East China Sea, I should say, that were going to be given back to China after the war. And because there's a present-day dispute about whether Japan or China should control certain islands that sit halfway between the two countries in the East China Sea, the Chinese have started to look back to World War II, look at the evidence and the data from that time, and then yank it out and use it as a way of making a very present-day, very immediate claim against their neighbours in Japan, with whom, I think it's no great secret to say, they don't always get on very well.
So it's a way of reinstating China on the if not the international scene, but definitely on the regional arena as a power that needs to be restored to its rights.
Yes, it very much is. One of the things that's worth noting is that in China itself, there is a great deal of discussion by the leadership, Xi Jinping, the president of China, and many of the top leaders of the Chinese Communist Party, about the need for what they call a great Chinese renaissance. The term Fuxing, renaissance, is used to explain the overall idea that China has, for too many years, either hidden its light under a shade, or that while it's become an economic power, now of course the second biggest economy in the world, it hasn't really yet sought to exercise influence in the wider world. And so Asia, its own backyard, is certainly part of that agenda. But one of the ways in which it's seeking to do that is to draw on past history. So it's all very well to say, look, we have huge amounts of money, our economy is growing. If you are Indonesia or Malaysia or Myanmar or any of these countries, we can offer you a great trade deal. And that obviously on a day-to-day basis and on an economic basis is very important. What it doesn't do is provide what you might call a moral narrative, a story not just about how China can be more powerful in that part of the world, but why it should be. Mm. And by looking at that past history of imperialism in the region and saying, first of all, China suffered at the hands of the British, the French, the Americans in the late 19th, early 20th century. And then in the mid-20th century, China fought back. And it fought back not just for itself, but also to liberate Asia from Japanese invasion and to allow it to be part of that post-war world, which did embrace freedom and democracy and all sorts of other things too. Now, freedom and democracy obviously sit rather troublingly in the mouths of today's Chinese Communist Party, who are not keen on any kind of liberal government. But they are these days able to bring back and share in that wider story that China was part of the effort that destroyed the Axis powers and their menace. And to that extent, I think the comparison is maybe not so much with America or Britain, but with the Soviet Union, which of course had, an extremely dictatorial government, but was on the Allied side during World War II.
But the analogy in a reverse way with the Russia-Soviet Union is also interesting in a sense that a nationalist government in Russia today encompasses a communist past, while a communist China of today actually encompasses a nationalist past. But the war between the nationalists and the communists was also the Chinese civil war in a way. But I guess the Kuomintang, which were the nationalist party in a way, is rehabilitated because of their resistance against Japan. Is that how...
That's a very fair summary. And also, I like the way in which you express that reversal, that essentially Russia and China have almost kind of got diametrical opposite positions in terms of how their communist and their nationalist revolutions reflect on each other. What's worth remembering in both cases, of course, is that the communist side and the nationalist side are not entirely separable from each other. Clearly, communists are nationalists too, and many of those nationalists were actually quite inclined towards a sort of more welfare and socially revisionist orientation in terms of their politics. But in terms of the way in which memory works, particularly in the case of China, you're right to say that by rehabilitating elements of the past, the Chinese Communist Party has had to undertake something of an ideological shift. It's had to move away from the story that it told to its own people for more than 50 years, which was that we, the Communist Party, defeated the Nationalists, the Kuomintang Party of Chiang Kai-shek, which was, you know, essentially unutterably evil, which was a feudal relic, which basically did all the worst things you can possibly imagine until we came and cleared them away. Now, when discussed in the context of whether the Communists or the Nationalists should have won control of China, that story hasn't changed. But where it has changed is in, at first grudgingly, but now fairly openly, an admission that actually, when it comes to one particular crisis, the Second World War against Japan between 1937, when it broke out in China, and 1945, when, of course, it ended, the Chinese Nationalists, along with, of course, the Chinese Communists, did both play a role in terms of pushing back and fighting against the forces of darkness in the shape of Japan. And that element has become much more openly discussed in China in the last, you know, 30 years or so. Part of that is instrumental. That's to do with the fact that, of course, reunification with Taiwan is on the minds of many in the Chinese leadership, and therefore being nice about the nationalist leadership who went there after 1949 might be helpful. But I think even more than that, it is to do with this much bigger question, which is not solved today, of how can today's China, richer than it was, consumerist in many ways, find a morally sustaining narrative that enables it to tell its own people a story that can give them a sense of pride and accomplishment.
And then, of course, any other type of alternative historiography is sometimes, I think, even declared as historical nihilism. I read it in one of the interviews with you. Could we explain this term? What is historical nihilism from a Chinese perspective?
The term historical nihilism has been used in the last few months and years by the very top leadership. Xi Jinping, I think, has certainly used the expression, and there are others who have brought it up too. In the everyday usage, if one wants to put it that way, it usually refers to versions of very recent history that do not place the Chinese Communist Party and its officials in the most positive light possible. So, for instance, revealing that, say, Chairman Mao's, Chairman Mao's tactics involved elimination of his political opponents, I think might be regarded as historical nihilism on the grounds that this doesn't portray the former chairman in the best light possible. There'll be other examples of that sort. More broadly speaking, though, it's really about a sort of intellectual battle, which is the idea within the party that it should control history, that history is not just something in the past to be studied by scholars and academics and debated. Also, it's a live and powerful and potent political tool. And in that sense, the nihilism comes from the idea almost that Chinese history cannot simply be regarded as something neutral that, if necessary, could bust myths. It has to be regarded also as something that has the capacity to inspire and in many ways to shape the idea of nationhood. And therefore, it cannot freely be allowed simply to follow any path that historians choose to take. Something which, as you can imagine, is rather trying for many of the very professional historians who actually work in China.
If this is the historiographical position right now, what type of implication does it have for politics in general, but also on the international arena, with relations with, for example, China and the United States?
It has a lot of influence on the way both that China thinks about itself domestically and in terms of international politics. So, for instance, many of the examples used by China to explain its own recent history may be pulled out at some moment of diplomatic negotiation. So an example of that would be when dealing with the United Kingdom, my own country. I think it is fair to say that in British high schools and in British history courses in general, there isn't always a great deal of attention to empire. as part of Britain's history, unless it's explicitly, of course, on empire and imperialism. But in terms of the domestic history of Britain, empire always sits sort of off the edge. Mm. And that means that stories, for instance, like the opening, the forced opening up by British gunboats of the China coast in the 1830s and 1840s to enable opium to be brought into China and sold there to, you know, the Chinese population, for missionaries to basically go in downriver and bring Christianity and so forth. These are not stories that are commonly told in British high schools. The Chinese, of course, tell those stories to their students in their high schools every day of the year. And when you, for instance, get a British governmental delegation coming to China, these are not necessarily the kind of experienced diplomats who, of course, know China very well, but perhaps the politicians who've only just basically done their homework about China 3 days before in the ministry before showing up, and they want to sign a big deal on trade. It has been seen that the Chinese find it useful sometimes to remind them of the longer history. Ah, yes, you know, Britain, of course, a friend now, but only 150 years that you were looking to invade our country and sell opium. And this can be quite a useful tactic to sometimes put Britain on the back foot when it comes to the starting point for the negotiation. So that's one example of the way in which historical examples can be used to try and make your position more advantageous in contemporary international diplomacy.
Mm. I actually had a personal similar experience many years ago. I was the press secretary of the Minister of Industry of Sweden, and we were in Beijing. And at that time, this was 92-93, direct after the Tiananmen massacre, all the Swedish politicians were instructed to remind China of human rights issues. And the Chinese, his Chinese counterpart, Chinese industry minister, went into a 10-15 minute speech on how the West had used the issues of human rights for intrusions in China. So I guess hasn't this always been a way of not as only the Chinese, but also many other countries of you Westerners or you outsiders should not come to tell us how to conduct our own affairs?
So I think the answer to your question is that yes, but there's also a way to push back. And that is also to use history. So let's take human rights, which is a very obvious example of an issue where there continues to be a big set of controversies between the liberal world, not just the West, but also, you know, other parts of the world, including Japan and China, which does not give the same stress to individual civil rights in the way that Sweden, the UK, or Japan would choose to do. Now, arguing that imperialism has often been cloaked in the argument of human rights is an argument that has been used for a long time. But in some cases, it's not without foundation. The fact is, I mentioned Christian missionaries earlier, and the fact is that Christianity, which of course preaches brotherly love, preaches equality under God, was brought essentially with guns and the sword into China, and that didn't give it necessarily the best of reputation, at least in the 19th century. But it's also worth pointing out, and indeed I have made this point in China myself, that if you go to 1948, this is one of the great moments for human rights, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And in the West, we tend to associate it with people like Eleanor Roosevelt. It's often forgotten that, of course, P.H. Jung, who's actually been researched by a very interesting Swedish scholar, Hans Roth, who's based here in Stockholm,
yes. I think, actually. Hans-Ingvar Roth, yes.
Yeah, no. Exactly, Hans-Ingvar Roth, who's written about P.H. Jung. This work has pointed out that, in fact, China itself was involved in the redefinition of human rights and the idea that there is a universal idea behind it, that individual rights as well as collective rights have their place as well. And by bringing Mr. Zhang, the Chinese philosopher who contributed to it, into the conversation, one can then turn it back to, well, okay, maybe we have different views, but if you're arguing about Chinese definition of human rights, you need to argue with your own Chinese philosophers, not just with Westerners.
So in a way of meeting this discussion in China is also to know your own history better, I guess.
I think that's fair to say. I think one of the things that is absolutely essential, particularly, you know, I come from the United Kingdom, and obviously the UK is currently remaking its relationship with Europe and the world, I think, in the wider sense. I think as the UK looks to approach countries like China and deepen their relationship in terms of trade, it will become not just desirable, but essential for the people going into that negotiation for the British side to know more about Chinese history, because otherwise they will be blindsided by people suddenly mentioning the Opium Wars or human rights or World War II or, you know, whatever it might be. And being informed about these issues gives you a way to be polite, respectful, but also able to use an informed position to say, here is why we agree, or here is why we disagree.
If we should look at the issue from a Chinese point of view, this concentration, if not obsession, about history, could that lead to some distorted political decisions in a way that you misinterpret your own history, especially if it's an official history without any other alternative interpretations?
I think that is a danger. And the place I think where it has the most danger attached to it is in what you might call the contemporary history of the People's Republic itself, because, you know, it's more than 70 years now since the founding of the PRC under the People's Republic of China under Chairman Mao in 1949. And at least two major historical events during that period, the Great Leap Forward of the 1950s, early 60s, which caused a famine, which killed many tens of millions of people in some calculations, and the Cultural Revolution of the mid-1960s and 70s, which caused fewer direct immediate deaths but destroyed large parts of the education system and infrastructure of China. These events are not entirely ignored in China. It's not fair to say that they are ignored completely, but they're not discussed in any great detail, and they are not given the kind of analysis as to why they happened that would be, I think, very important for a fuller historical understanding of the period. So that leads sometimes to contemporary decisions, I think, going in an odd sort of direction. For instance, one of the reasons that is sometimes given for China not becoming a more liberal society in terms of free media, for instance, is that freedom, too much freedom, anarchy, was what nearly destroyed China during the Cultural Revolution, and that China should never go back to that. Now, anyone who looks at the history of the Cultural Revolution will know that it had nothing to do with free media or people's ability to debate politics. It had to do much more with the insertion of a very violent, very, in some ways, insurrectionist political struggle, actually initiated by Mao himself against his own party. And the results of that, of course, then reverberated for the best part of a decade. But because it's not possible in detail to discuss or look at the details of the Cultural Revolution within China itself, there's no place to debate what it actually meant, and therefore no place either to prove or disprove that arguments that more political participation at a popular level would be a good idea might in fact have some weight to them.
But the internal wars in China from the Warring State period forwards is always brought up also in a from a Han nationalistic point of view of that it is necessary to have a very centralized control over China because it's too big, too disparate, and if it's not controlled by a monolithic power structure of any kind, an emperor or the party, it will then lead to civil war. That is a part of the Chinese storytelling. Isn't there some kind of a truth in it in that sense?
But it's worth pointing out that China has perhaps been, let's say, if you say the imperial period begins, say, about, the pre-imperial period starts about 700-800 BCE, and then the first formal empire, the Qin, many people would say, in the 200s BCE. So if you look at that long stretch of imperial government, there are many periods when China is unified from a central dynasty and a central emperor. There are also, of course, many periods when it is not. And one of the reasons the periods when it's not unified occur is that centralization has gone too far. When you have a system that either is highly authoritarian from the top and is unable to deal with difference and nuance and the ability really to have a flexibility in government, or a sort of almost reverse problem, a desire to control things from above, but an inability or unwillingness to actually provide the infrastructure to do so, that's when you end up with these periods when China essentially becomes a series of competing states or even warring states on occasion. It's also worth noting, and you talked about Han nationalism, two, maybe even three of the most flourishing periods of Chinese history over 3,000 or 4,000 years are periods when either foreigners have been in charge of China or they have been very influential. So the Mongol dynasty, the Yuan of the, 1100s to 1200s on, is a period when China was essentially part of a larger, quite loose polity that was founded by the Khans. And yet, of course, in many ways, it was a period when everything from drama to architecture in Beijing to, of course, the sheer spread of territory that was controlled continued to grow and deepen. Or, of course, the Qing dynasty, the very last dynasty in China from 1644 to 1911, was a period when the Manchus rather than the Han Chinese, and the Manchus with their own language and military ceremonies and so forth were actually in charge. Or even the Tang Dynasty back in the medieval era from the 600s to the 900s was a period when you did have a Chinese dynasty on the throne, but there was huge influence from Central Asia. Buddhism flourished, of course, a religion that comes in from India and then sort of spreads through China. So the cosmopolitanism and also the ability to actually be quite flexible marks a lot of what really makes China's most powerful periods very effective. The idea that it's simply a top-down emperor who basically exercises his will has very rarely been the case.
I guess that description would be described as historical nihilism, or...?
Not necessarily. It depends, of course, who's doing the asking. I think it's fair to say that there isn't a huge objection, partly because there can't be, to the factual statement that many of China's major dynasties, or certainly two and others were influenced, were run by people who are not Han nationalists. Where I think there has been more sensitivity and often huge arguments within China is on that sort of wider question of what defines them as Chinese. So to take the Qing dynasty, the Manchus, you can make the argument, in fact, it's a big debate in the historical field. You can make the argument on the one hand, what's called the sinification thesis, that these people, yes, they're ethnic Manchus, but they study the works of Confucius. Mm. They use the traditional imperial systems of government. They basically govern territory that is the traditional Chinese empire, and they even add parts of it. So, okay, they're foreigners, but really they're a Chinese dynasty. Or you can go with the ethnicity thesis, which says, look, these guys use their own language for their most important documents. They wear different clothes from the Han Chinese. They have military formations called banners that are not ethnic Han dynasties. So actually, they're Manchus who are basically in charge of Chinese territory. And of course, that's the kind of thing from which historical debate takes place. I think it's fair to say at the moment, the ethnically driven interpretation is less politically favoured in China by some way, because it seems to, I think from the point of view of today's rulers, argue against the idea that China has always been one big happy family. But certainly in terms of the scholarly discussion, the academic conversation, there's much more variation and much more debate.
Mm. If we should go back to the where we started with the rewriting of Chinese history or revisiting it in a narrative, what implications would that have to the Chinese-U.S. relations as of today, from an American standpoint? That would be my final question, in a way. Maybe that would require for another half an hour, but we don't have that time.
No, unfortunately, I think the answer to that question could be much shorter. I think U.S.-China relations would be immeasurably improved if both sides spent more time thinking about the shared history that they have. Let me use my own research area, perhaps to give the final example of why that might be. It is not well remembered in America that China was an ally to the United States between the 1930s and 1940s against the Japanese. And when it's remembered, it's usually thought of with the Chinese as sort of junior partners who were pretty corrupt, they didn't really fight very well, and the Americans had to come and rescue them. This is not the way the Chinese see it. What they see is themselves as the people who were forced into entering the war long before the Americans ever came along. They were fighting essentially on their own since 1937, and then essentially had to wait for Pearl Harbor in 1941 before they had got significant military assistance from the Americans. And that story in China has become sort of a metaphor for the idea of the Americans essentially placing their own interpretation ahead of that might understand the other person's point of view. On the other hand, I think it's fair to say that that story also can be used in China to fuel a kind of us against the world nationalism, the idea that for China to thrive, other people have to acknowledge that in some way they are not part of that wider shared history. And I think that's a very unfortunate direction to go in as well. So I think an understanding that, in fact, an alliance of that sort, even between very different sorts of partners, was able, at least in the short term, in the 30s and 40s, to get a particular task done, the defeating of the Axis powers, could be used as a springboard, as a metaphor for understanding that contemporary issues such as US-China trade also should be about mutual decisions, not about one side trying to outdo or outflank the other and use history as a sort of weapon to try and shame the other side. That's never a very... Not only is that a bad use of politics, it's also a bad use of history.
Professor Mitter, thank you very much.
Thank you.